We've been on the road with Wildlife and with Buster Scruggs, and Paul's in this Showtime series. So we've been doing all of this press, and when we first figured out our fall and having the baby and everything, we were like, oh, we'll have the fall off from work, and instead we've been, you know, on the road.
And you actually seem to be working harder than anybody else on in some of these movies. In these situations, you're like the front man. You're kind of like...
Singing
the song. Well, Buster Scruggs, you've been kind of out there more than other people. And...
Yeah, they seem to be... Well, you know, I'm the only girl, so maybe there's a...
The official woman of Buster Scruggs. So, I guess nothing is really planned with an actor, right?
No, nothing is planned. That's absolutely correct.
So, the timing of everything just kind of happened that it did. I mean, when you did Buster Scruggs, they were already thinking of the movie?
Yes. Yes, I mean, I think there was a miscommunication at some point about what exactly, you know, it's an anthology film, it's a weird form, and so I think it first got reported as being, like, television, but what you see on screen is exactly what the script was, so it was always this very strange movie hybrid thing, but I really love it, and I am so truly, like, and I don't mean this as like a PR line, I'm so inspired by the Coens in terms of how they keep like reinventing the form for themselves. I think a lot of people who are artists of that stature who have been so lauded for doing a particular thing will then like stick to that thing, and they just keep, like, they have such a rangy curiosity about what cinema can be, and so it was really exciting to be part of this movie.
A very definitive voice, but a very kind of interest in a lot of different places.
Yeah, exactly. Like, both, like, unmistakable and also ever-changing.
So when you got the script, I mean, is it just a key when the Coens say,
yeah,
do you want to do this?
Yeah, it is.
Let's see what it is. Do you talk to, do you give them notes on their script, or do you just sit there trying to figure out
what
to
do?
No, well, sometimes.
No, not in a million years. I mean, not in a million years. That would be like giving Tennessee Williams notes or something. No, I mean, I think one of the great, for me, one of the great pleasures of being an actor is like encountering text and trying to figure out the puzzle of it. How does it work? Why does it work? What are they trying to say? And, you know, the Coens write at a level that is not unlike Chekhov or Williams or something like that, where it's like the more you put into it, the more you get back kind of experience.
So do you get to ask questions? Are you allowed to really...
Yeah, they're not, they're a little, they don't love to explain their work, I think.
That I know for sure.
They do love to collaborate. They've been working with a lot of the same crew for years and years and years. And I do think that there's a kind of... They're looking for something very precise. But I never had a conversation with them about my character. I never had a conversation about backstory or... you know, we had half a day of rehearsal. I auditioned for them twice for the role, so in those auditions, those were like kind of fact-finding mission for me, in a way, of figuring out what makes them laugh, and where is the sweet spot of this character, and, but no, there wasn't a lot of dialogue about it.
And she's pretty complicated. Her evolution through the piece, through this first segment of this, is not obvious.
No, I think that's right.
Which is, and do you feel like you have an answer for what her purpose was and what they were trying to express through her, or do you just figure her out as best you can and live her?
I don't have any sense of what they were trying to communicate, which I think is a good thing, actually, where at least it's, I don't know, like, I was talking with Joel about it last night. We had the premiere last night at the AFI gala, and he was saying sort of like, if you could explain it, you wouldn't need to make the piece of art. And I really get that. I really get that as a writer. I think as a writer, I'm always approximating what I really mean when I try to describe it. As an actor, though, it's an interpretive art. So you are trying to figure out something concrete, even if it's just for yourself, you know, so making decisions about Tim Blake Nelson said something, which is a Mark Wing Davey quote in one of these Q&As, where he said the actor is responsible for the history of any action. And that's sort of why you make concrete decisions as an actor that are, in the end of the day, kind of arbitrary. Some of them. I mean, some of them are really text-based, but like little things like I talk about my brother having failed businesses. Like, was he gambling with family money? Did I think that they were foolish from the start? At what point, if I didn't think they were foolish from the start, at what point did I stop hero worshiping my brother and start thinking that he was an idiot? Is that something that I've allowed myself to think privately, or is that something that occurs to me as I'm saying these lines? You know, so you just end up making decisions because you have to, be coming from someplace, and you want the feeling of that feeling of certainty on set, where you feel like the authority on this person, even if it's a false authority.
Well, and Wildlife also, as a film, ebbs and flows between being clear and allowing the audience to make decisions about what's really going on,
yeah,
and
what
the subtext of everything is constantly. Is that, as a writer, an intention as you're working on that script?
Yeah, it was. You know, the book by Richard Ford that we adapted is really told from the perspective of this son recalling his parents' marriage falling apart and his feeling of helplessness. We set it in a more present tense way. The book reflects back on his childhood. We set it like squarely inside of his childhood. So there isn't that sort of sense of omniscience, of adult awareness of the child's world. But you know, the book is filled with his thoughts and perspective, and you just can't have someone's inner life like that on film as articulated. So some of it was us trying to figure out, like, how do we show in images the thoughts that this kid is having? And also, his parents are a real mystery to him in the book. And he's sort of, Richard Ford is not giving a ton of information about their inner life. You know, he's not giving a ton of emotional information around the things that they say and do. But on screen, you're getting a lot more emotional information off the actors' faces. So figuring out, like, what's the fine line? Like, how much do we let the parents' inner lives be shown on screen? How much do we, with the camera and with writing, deprive the audience of that? We want them always to be leaning forward and thinking that these people are interesting and mysterious the same way that Joe, our protagonist, our teenage protagonist, does, but also feel like these are real people and not just enigmas cobbled together to make you lean forward. You know, I kept saying as we were adapting, even if Joe doesn't understand his parents, we have to understand them. Even if the audience never receives that information, we need to have it as dramatists, in much the same way that as an actor walking onto the Coen Brothers set, I had to pretend like I knew everything about Alice before I stepped onto that set.
Well, in the kid, you kind of, it's clear that it's his story, but it also doesn't lean, as a viewer, I guess, you don't really feel like, oh, it's his movie, I guess, in some ways.
Right.
You don't give it so much to him that it bends it into a child's perspective on what's going on.
Yeah.
You're watching as he's watching.
Yes,
mostly.
Well, I kept saying to Paul when we were working on it, we have to weaponize his watching. There's a sort of way in the book he can feel very passive because he's being put in a very passive position by his parents.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they are making decisions for his life and he's sort of just going along with it. Paul felt a huge sense of identification with that. Like, he's often said in these kinds of interviews that, you know, he wasn't the kind of kid who was acting out. He was the kind of kid that was trying to keep his family together and, you know, doing everything he could to be helpful. And that's very much true of Joe. Like, he's even though his parents are putting him in this passive position, he's trying to be as active as possible. So finding little ways to show that, like, we added something about him fixing the toilet as a way of, like, showing just how helpless he was and how much he wanted to help. I don't know. I think when we were adapting it, at one point, we, as an experiment, cut out anything that the parents were in that the child wasn't in, to see, like, if we just stay within his perspective, what does it feel like? And it felt like a much smaller movie. It felt like something, like a YA novel or something. And I think that there's something about the crumbling of the American nuclear family. It's set in 1960, so at a time when our culture was about to change so much, that has a kind of like big scope to it, and required us to live a little bit in the private lives of those parents.
You kind of wonder what two generations of divorce being as dominant as it's become in our culture means to a kid who's going through it in 2018.
Yeah.
You know, like, as a kid, do kids go through it the same way they did back then, or 20 years ago, or 30 years ago? Or is it so prevalent now that they don't even believe that they're, you know, that help keep getting their parents back together?
Right.
Which has always been the kind of dramatic narrative that people have chosen to look at.
Right.
Even exists anymore.
Well, I imagine that it will always feel like your world is ending if your family changes that dramatically. I'm sure some of the shame around it is different, though. Like, I have a friend who's 15 years older than me, and she described when her parents split up in the 70s, and how they were the only kids they knew who had divorced parents, and so it was this massive source of shame. And, you know, that just isn't the case anymore. So I bet there is some difference culturally.
Yeah. My sister tells a story. She was a preschool teacher at the University of Chicago for many years, and when her son was 12 or whatever, he got a bee bite, and he ended up with an EpiPen because he was so allergic. But he was the only one in school, and they were negotiating how to bring the EpiPen to school, and could he hold on to it, or did he have to give it to a teacher, blah, blah, blah. By the time she, 15 years later, 20 years later, there was a case at school and every kid, you know, all but two kids had an EpiPen.
Yeah.
It's how these things change is... And when you're that close to it, you don't notice the big change around.
Totally. Well, one of the things that I find really interesting is that, you know, the movie takes place sort of like pre-women's movement in a lot of ways, or pre-second wave feminism. Mm-hmm. But Carrie Mulligan's character, Jeanette, is going through a kind of revolution in her own life. She's trying very hard to individuate and to step outside of the archetypes of wife and mother. But she's doing that in a vacuum. Like, there's no cultural story around her that's helping her understand that movement in her own life. In a way, the same thing is true for Jake Gyllenhaal's character, Jerry. Like, he's failing to live up to the archetype of father and provider, at least as he has been taught that they should be reached. And he does this very drastic thing in response to try to reassemble his masculinity for himself.
Well, both of the parents are kind of classic movie and literature archetypes.
Yeah.
But you guys don't do them that way.
Well,
you guys take them in a different place.
People don't, you know, people aren't archetypal. Yeah. They have a relationship. What's interesting to me is that both of those characters have a relationship to archetype. Not just we have a relationship to archetype when we look at those characters. They themselves are struggling with archetype or archetypal ideas.
Well, Karen, we talked to Karen about it, and she actually seemed less, I see her character as extremely just strong and figuring out what she has to do to survive and go forward and doing it.
Yeah.
And she seemed to see her as more troubled and having more of a, you know, struggling more and misstepping more. And I didn't think she got into it not so great, but I didn't find her to be misstepping. I just found her stepping. Like, she had no choice.
I think that both things are true, for me at least. I think that she is a person who is incredibly practical and she's trying to do the incredibly practical thing and like you said, move forward, like move forward at all costs. Jerry, her husband, has sort of been stalled out by disappointment, and she is keeping their family afloat and keeping them moving. And in doing so, I think she starts to discover a sense of herself. But I think she's incredibly ill-equipped to be the breadwinner of her family, to be an independent person from her husband or from her child. Society and her marriage have not given her the tools to express herself. And so I do think that she, in just stepping forward, she missteps in order to be able to individuate.
I saw a bit of a snippet of an interview with Hall about the movie, and it sounded, from his take on it, in terms of the writing, that you also kind of fell into it a little, not randomly, but
yeah,
it wasn't like a thought out, okay, this is how we're going to write together process, you just kind of figured it out as you went along.
That's right.
And was it, did the process make you want to try that process again? Not sitting in a room together, pounding on the typewriter?
Yeah, we both wrote at separate times. I can't imagine doing it any other way, to be totally honest. I think part of the reason I love writing, in contrast to acting, or why both things are important to me, is that acting is something that you do in public. You know, your creative process is always with people. And even if you're doing a tremendous amount of preparation alone, at the end of the day, you need a camera, you need a witness, you need another person there. Most of the time, you need another actor. Writing is something you can do all by yourself. I sort of have always felt like I cherished that private experience. That said, this was the first time I've written for a particular director. Like, we optioned this book knowing that Paul would direct it. And I had a very strong sense from him vocally, but also from him over the course of living together, of what kind of film he wanted to make and what kind of film he saw here in Wildlife. So I was really, I think I needed space of having just me and my computer and me and my imagination in order to be able to help him, like, give birth to this thing. I think if he had been looking over my shoulder the whole time, I would have just said, oh, you do it yourself. I think he, in letting me be a part of the writing process, had to turn over the reins to me at least part of the time.
So, I was going to say, did you feel like an editor sometimes? Or did you feel, was it always a full, like an edit, like editing, you were editing him?
Yeah, both
things. As you were writing, or both?
I mean, you know, our process was sort of like, he would do a draft, I would give him notes, he would go back and polish, then he would hand it over to me, I'd do a draft, he'd give me notes, I would polish, like that. We wrote it over the course of 3 years together, but we weren't writing all the time for 3 years. Like, Paul shot multiple movies, I shot multiple movies, I did plays during that period of time, and sometimes both of us would be working so hard that neither of us would have any time to work on it, and then we would come back to it with new eyes and sort of see things afresh. I think we learned as we went, and I think if, I don't know, I think in screenwriting, like, there's no such thing as an editor, right? The way that if you wrote a novel, you'd have an editor.
Right.
And I think it's sort of a needed job. Like, most of the time, the people who are giving you notes have some investment financially or ego-wise in what's being written. So it's sort of great to have a more neutral partner who could look at something and be like, you know, I just think it was so much stronger when we had that scene or when we didn't have dialogue there or whatever the thing is.
I always wonder about the studio executives and whether there must be one or two in the history of the last 20 years that was, you know, really a great editor and not just giving notes about, you know, we need more shots of the celebrity or whatever.
There must be. You know. I mean, I don't know because I've never written anything for a studio, so I've really never had that experience.
Right. So you never do, when you do indie work, do you get a lot of notes?
You know, my first script was, well, my first script that I tried to have made was Ruby Sparks. Mm-hmm. And I gave that to Ron Yerkes and Albert Berger, and mm-hmm. I did some work off of their notes. But then once State and Ferris came on, they sort of were at the helm of the ship, and right. they...
And the writers also.
They're not writers.
Oh, I thought they were.
No, but they have a very, they really think it has to be on the page before it can be on screen. They have a very strong relationship with the writing process. They really like, you know, they worked on the script, they helped develop the script on Little Miss Sunshine for 5 years or something. Mm-hmm. This was a much more truncated process. Like, we were in pre-production maybe 6 months after they signed on to the movie. And so, I was doing a lot of rewrites for them to their notes. And then, yeah, Fox Searchlight came on, to finance the movie and to distribute it, and they did have notes. But I feel like I've always been cushioned by having like incredibly intelligent collaborators that I was like writing for and working with.
So writing for theater, where the writer is a guy?
That's different. I mean,
she says with a smile.
No, writing for theater, I've written twice on commission, which is the only time I've ever done that, you know, because I've written, my other scripts have been spec scripts. So that's actually the only time that I've written for producers that had input from very early. And I didn't find it to be particularly wonderful. And I don't think I'd do it again. I don't think I'll write on commission again for the theater. I really liked being able to decide when my play was ready to be produced or to be given to people.
So you write something on spec, I guess, or?
Yeah. My fourth play, I wrote, and that it was produced, but I worked on it in private before I ever gave it to any producers. I think it can be really harmful to turn over your work too early, which is what I did. I mean, it's on me as well. You know, it's a learning experience. I just really wanted to please the producers who had commissioned my work. Mm-hmm. And so I think I gave it to them to read before it was really ready.
It's funny because it's the magic of always, you know, any movie that's good is a magic of experiments that it actually happened. But it also, it comes through so many different, there's so many bad ways that can also lead to something good.
Yeah.
And there's so many good ways that can lead to something bad. And it's interesting because you never really know.
That's right.
Maybe something good comes of the unhappy experience and all that.
Totally. So it's very rare that you have a great time making something and it turns out great and people like it. Like, it's a rare, rare thing. So you gotta appreciate it when it works out that way.
It turns out great. It turns out okay or terrible or whatever.
Right.
But there's so little content when you look at the massive content that's mm-hmm. created now that's really strong.
Right.
It's almost shocking sometimes how, you know, you want to pick the fruit out of the tree because it's so right. exciting when it's finally, when there is something great.
Well, I'll say this. I think it's making, like, writing my own work and having it produced has made me, like, understand how hard it is to make even, like, the worst of movies. Like, even the thing that you see that you think is, like, a total POS, yeah. like, someone put their lifeblood into that thing. Probably many people put their lifeblood into that thing. And the fact that it didn't turn out great is breaking someone's heart and probably a lot of people's hearts. You know, I just have so much more empathy when I watch theater and film and TV now than I did when I was 22 and just starting out and, you know, was watching everything with my arms crossed thinking I could do it better. You know, now I think, like, goddamn, what a miracle. Like, every independent film that gets made is an absolute miracle.
It's always Roger Ebert and Jesus always just said, you know, if only somebody cared in this film. And I was like, it may be a terrible movie, but somebody cared. Somebody,
yeah, someone
for
cared
somebody,
a lot.
It was their career, it was their life, it was the thing that they cared about and loved.
Absolutely.
Even in really junky, you know, low budget, bad movies.
Yeah, that's absolutely the case.
Yeah. I was my brief screenwriting career was I stopped because I couldn't take it. Like,
yeah.
I didn't understand. To me, the idea of these guys who, you know, make a lot of money, but do screen, you know, do rewriting and do whatever and get 3 credits and make 50 movies, I'm like, I'd commit suicide halfway through that. I couldn't take it.
Yeah, I mean, there's so, I mean, my parents always say to us, like, you've got to celebrate when you can because you never know what the next step is going to be like. You know, like, I remember when John and Val signed on to Ruby Sparks, my mom was like, pop the champagne now because you never know if the movie's ever going to get made or, you know, what that's going to be like. And that can be, like, a kind of pessimistic way of looking at things, but it's also just, it's a good reminder of how hard any creative endeavor is.
So, you talked about writing and what it is to you.
Mm.
What is acting to you at this point?
You know, I went through a little bit of a feeling of, I guess a kind of version of depression or something a few years back, feeling like, why act? What is it doing for me? And it's a really hard profession. It's hard at every level. It's hard for people who never get to work, and it's hard, you know, when you're Julia Roberts. Like, I don't think it makes people particularly happy, the career of it. You're always asking for permission to do the thing you love. You're always waiting to be given something to help you express yourself. It's very tough, and obviously it's tough. It's harder, I think, on women than it is on men. And like a year of soul searching sort of produced for me the awareness that it gives me access to a part of myself that nothing else does. There's a part of me that's like a true empath that experiences my emotions too big and a kind of boundarylessness between me and other people, and not just people, but also people on the page. Like, when I read a novel, I feel sort of infected by the characters. And there's nothing else that helps organize that part of me like acting does. It allows those parts of me to make tremendous sense and be gifts to me rather than a burden to me. And I just had to readjust for myself what my expectations were in terms of how much happiness the career would give me and take the pleasure I can out of the actual work. So I work less than I used to, but I have loved the things I've made more. And I think I've also tried to reinvest for myself in my private life. I think that having a stronger relationship with a sense of ego that is not reliant on my work has been very good for me and has allowed me to have a more easy relationship with my work.
Mm. Well, now with a baby, you're stripped away of all ego.
Yeah, that's not what I mean. Ego identification, you know? Like, I think that there's a way that, I think it's a very human instinct to want to rely on something external to define yourself. And some people do it with, oh, my kids are my world. Or some people do it like, I'm a workaholic, right? Like, And I think for me, it used to be like, I'm an actor, and that is like the main thing that defines me. And allowing myself to think like that my worth does not come from my work or come from other people's appreciation of my worth, that my worth comes from who I am to the people in my life and who they are to me. That was very good for me, and I think having a child is sort of part of that picture.
Yeah. It's a mighty thing.
Yeah.
And people always say that, and you go, yeah, okay. And then you have one, and it's like, oh, that's what they were talking about.
Yeah.
You know, the thing when there's something that is just bigger than anything else, you're not in control of that feeling. It just is on such a grand basis that it's extraordinary.
Yeah, it's like a natural disaster.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And you're just kind of shoveling the whole time.
We were just at another press kind of thing with a woman who was interviewing me who was pregnant, and I was saying, like, don't be scared. It's not like the dentist. It's like a tsunami. Like, it's, you're really tapping into, like, earth force, like, the big forces, life, death, like, those things. And then it's also just, like, all the mundane little things of keeping a person alive.
You will find out who you are quickly when you have a baby. I'm sure you already have, but I mean, it challenges you in ways that you can't even, because it's a tsunami.
Well,
because it's, you know, until you're under that kind of pressure.
Totally.
Everything's a choice.
I feel a little bit right now like I did, I realized this thing about myself in my early 20s when I was in acting classes, where I would go, like, I'd be in acting class, I'd be working really hard, I would think I was learning a lot, and then like 6 months later or a year later, I'd be like, oh, that's what the teacher was trying to say, or like some penny would drop so long after the fact, because I had to shed all of the trying to please the teacher, trying to prove I was a good actor, trying to be competitive with the other people in my class. Like, when all of that went away, then like what I learned would reveal itself. And I feel a tiny bit that way right now, where I'm like, I'm just having to paddle so hard to stay above water, being a new parent, having these two movies come out, doing all this press, having to travel with her and figure out childcare situations, and also the massive adjustment of self that is happening in me and is happening in Paul as we adjust to this new portion of our lives, which will be the rest of our lives. It's very hard to do that and remain self-aware. And I kind of feel like, you know, in 6 months or a year, then I will have some sense of the change that is happening in me. Right now, I'm just like trying to keep my head above water.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Of course, I'm completely lying now, but...
don't worry.
Tracy Letts, was that...
Yeah.
Had a child last spring, and I was like, I'm so looking forward to seeing what comes out of his work 2 years from now, having gone through this experience, because it's going to be fascinating.
Uh-huh.
I mean, he's so interested in these areas already, but to see how it changes his perspective that little bit is going to be fascinating.
Yeah, especially as an artist of that age, you know, he's in his 50s, and so in some ways your life is calcified. You've achieved a certain level of success, you have a certain sense of who you are. I mean, that's true for me in my mid-30s, but it must really be true in your mid-50s.
Yeah.
So to have a huge life change, then, it's really interesting.
So, the other thing that I know you for is your politics. Thanks to Twitter and all of that.
Right.
Are you, at this crossroads we're at, this ongoing crossroads, it's changing, it seems like every week is another crossroads, but are you feeling hopeful? Are you feeling safe? Are you feeling good about the future? And you mentioned, you know, how hard it is for women as actors. Is that feeling like it's getting better in your perspective?
That's a good question. Look, for the second half of your question, I think it does feel like people's awareness of representation, of how women are treated in the workplace, that kind of thing feels like people's eyes on it more now than it has been. The politics, the gender politics of the stuff I read seems more balanced than it used to 10 years ago. But most of the stuff I see, most of the roles I see for women are still wives and mothers, and or people who are being defined as that. It still feels like to every 10 juicy male parts, there's one juicy female part. So I think we have to adjust the stories that we're telling and who gets to tell stories in order to change that balance. But honestly, I don't have tremendous hope that things will change in a global way, because the story of the history of misogyny is the history of the human race. I mean, there's nothing like having a baby to make you feel how powerful women are. I truly think that we're like supernaturally powerful, just in our biology, just in what we're able to do by having sex and then waiting 9 months. Like, that's extraordinary. And giving birth to my child, I truly felt like connected to massive earth forces. Like, I feel myself to be unbelievably powerful. And I think that there's a kind of long con that's been perpetrated on women in our society, in Western culture, out of fear of that power. I think that men have historically been terrified of women and have sought to oppress them through rape, through social domination, and by creating a gender construct that even biblically refers to them as the weaker sex. I mean, Eve being taken from Adam's body is a big joke, as far as I'm concerned. I will say that I don't feel a sense of hopelessness. I just think the tides of history are so strong, I would be shocked if there was permanent change. On the political end of things, I am tremendously relieved that that the Democrats retook the House.
Yes.
I feel so hopeless about the environmental stuff, and that feels like the more important. Nothing seems as important to me as what happens to our planet. I mean, having climate deniers in charge and making decisions about how funds should be allocated for rescue relief and for the treatment of our national parks does seem like a tiny thing that we can do to change. Like, if we can get these climate deniers out of power, that would be very helpful. But we have to make permanent changes as a society, and I don't mean like you and me recycling more. Like, I mean like from our corporations, we have to make permanent changes in the way that we treat our planet. And so like right now, as you and I talk, part of our city is burning, and that's a direct result of climate change. And I'm very scared for the future for my baby, and also for the human race. Like, it seems like we're in the middle of an apocalyptic moment, and and people are running around bird scooters and like taking selfies as Rome burns. You know, like I have nothing against selfies, I have nothing against bird scooters, but like I do think that we are distracting ourselves from the deep problem at hand.
So I think that's probably always been true. I think that people,
yeah,
you know, it's very hard to actually make real change.
It's terrifying.
It's terrifying, and it seems like such a big challenge.
It is such a big challenge.
That people are, and yet, you know, people voted this election, so it's not even, you can't even say that as much. This time out, but hopefully that will continue and grow and not dissipate, you know, because that's ultimately people taking control of what's in front of them changes everything.
Yeah.
That's the only way to change it.
Yeah.
Really, is to have people in position from which they can make change.
Yeah, absolutely, and encourage people who have not voted to vote.
Yeah. Well, I was talking to somebody about, we were talking about Florida and the felons law that they added, but also that the generation of people who are Parkland age, not just the Parkland kids, but all the kids who are that age in the state, will be able to vote. You know, half of them probably couldn't vote, or maybe two-thirds of them couldn't vote this time out. But in the next election, in 2020, right, they'll all be able to vote.
Yeah.
And that is really, should be a significant change in a state like Florida, where...
Yeah.
And where the issues of environmental stuff are actually even more extreme, almost, than California, because that state could go underwater.
Yeah.
You know, by the time Cameron's 25, or my kid's 25 years old.
Absolutely. I mean, I think one of the things that's, one of the things that you have the benefit of as you get older is understanding how short a decade is. I mean, in 10 years, your son will be voting. And that seems like impossible right now, right? Because he's less than a decade old.
Yeah.
But that time will go by so fast. And I think you're absolutely right. I think this generation of kids, I have a lot of hope pinned on this generation of kids, because they seem to have a relationship with empathy that's so much more profound than the generations that have come before.
And self-preservation is not an unknown
thing. No, that's right. That's
so
right.
At some point, they're going to figure out,
yes,
that we don't want to die.
Yes, that's right. And we don't want all of our cities to be underwater.
Yeah. We can't make every movie about going to Mars. So.
That's right.
But you've never been in a movie going to Mars yet, so.
No, I would love to be. I love a space film.
Do you love a space film?
I do.
So would you write a space film?
I don't know what I would have to say, but absolutely.
That would seem like a milieu that you could work in.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, my last play was a science fiction thing set underground, post planet meltdown.
Well, I am incredibly happy for you and your beloved husband, and I can't think of two better people to keep on creating more children.
Nice.
You're now responsible to have at least 7 or 8 kids.
Great, or at least 7 or 8 more movies.
Or at least 7 or 8 more movies.
Yeah.
But it's you guys, you're both... exhibit a kindness and a generosity of spirit that I think is a very nice thing to see, particularly in this industry.
Well, that's
where it can
nice.
Be a little bit bitter and rough.
Well, so. Wait 20 years. I might get there.
I'm looking forward to doing that interview. I'll be
great.
In a wheelchair, but I'll be doing the interview.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Hey. Thanks, David.
Thank you.
Great.
My wife does her plants.